Are you ready?
It's ready.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Susan. Welcome to May 10th, 2016, regular meeting. Are there any public comments this morning? Seeing none, we'll adjourn into closed session. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
So welcome to our Calaveras County Board of Supervisors, May 10th, 2016, regular meeting. Could you please stand for the pledge?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which stands one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Just tap the...
Where's the mute?
All this technology. Before we move on to any public comments, we had two closed session items this morning. We had a conference with legal counsel on anticipated litigation, initiation of litigation, one case pursuant to Government Code Section 54956.9D4, and there was no action taken. The second was conference with legal counsel and anticipated legal litigation, significant exposure to litigation, claim number 2016-03-Angela Farmer, pursuant to Government Code Section 54956.9D2, County Council, no action taken. Correct. And so number three, we haven't done it yet. And so, any board announcements? Any announcements?
If I may, Chair, I just wanted to make mention of the artwork that is now displayed in the board chambers. The project was created by our Spirit Committee. Thank you, Megan. Spirit Committee. It was a group initially self-formed by a number of employees that wanted to do things that would help improve morale, lighten spirits, what have you. And they came up with this project, which was an effort to highlight the talents of local artists, with the current focus being on an employee artist. The artwork will be displayed for 30 to 60 days, and you can find a brief biography about our artist, Jane Carter, in the lobby bulletin board. But these are all her original artworks, and she is an employee with the county.
Okay. And thank you for that. Just some really good art and local. So now we have recognition and acknowledgments. And Supervisor Kearney, would you like to go forward to the first one? Sorry. Yeah, just do Supervisor Kearney's first, okay? He's going to do the poppies.
Okay, item number five from the administrative office, adopt a proclamation designating May as Poppy Month in Calaveras County.
Good morning, everybody. First, I want to thank the supervisors for allowing me from our American Legion Auxiliary Unit 102 in Valley Springs to appear before you to make a request that you read a proclamation making May 2016 the Poppy Month, coinciding with the Memorial Day services being held later on this month. when the American Legion Auxiliary adopted the poppy in October 1921. It pledged 100% of the profits from the poppy distribution to the welfare for servicemen and women and the families, and is still in effect today. Last year, when I appeared before you, I never realized that this year, 2016, we would need even more funding to take care of our servicemen and servicewomen who are unable to take care of themselves, and for some of them, their children. We hope that by this proclamation, word will go out to our community, asking the public, please give generously. Those brave warriors were there when our country needed them. Now they need us. Thank you.
We need to pick this up, right? We said last time, yeah.
Thanks, Steve.
Where'd you get the sign? I'm excited to be able to give this proclamation. I have a soft spot in my heart for all the veterans, but I especially know that we all see these red poppies, and to have a better understanding of what they actually mean is very important. I am asking the Board of Supervisors to proclaim the month of May as Poppy Month. Whereas the poppy story began during World War I when a Canadian doctor, Lieutenant Colonel John McCrae, wrote a poem he named In Flanders Fields. He noticed that where it once was a bloody battlefield, it now was covered with red poppies. His poem was dedicated to the fallen soldiers and their sacrifices, and whereas each year American Legion Auxiliary volunteers all over the country distribute millions of the red crepe paper poppies in exchange for contributions to help disabled and hospitalized veterans, and whereas the American Legion Auxiliary in Valley Springs will be passing out poppy paper flowers in the community during May to commemorate the use of the poppy that became the official flower in 1923 as a symbol and memory of the soldiers who fought in the battlefields during World War I, and whereas the poppies are made by disabled veterans for rehabilitation and a way to supplement their incomes and make them more self-sufficient, and whereas the American Legion Auxiliary's mission is to provide support to veterans, all proceeds from donations are used exclusively to aid disabled veterans, their families, and children. Now, therefore, be it proclaimed that the Board of Supervisors, Calaveras County, hereby declares May 2016 to be Poppy Month.
Okay, can I have a motion, please?
I so move.
Okay. I'll second.
I have a motion by Supervisor Olivera, second by Supervisor Ponte.
Public
comment. Any public comment on this?
Call for a vote.
Can I
have
a vote, please?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's 5-0.
Passed and adopted by the Board of Supervisors, County of Calaveras, State of California, this 10th day of May, 2016.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you
so much, Steve.
Thank you.
A lot of people
want a poppy, I might as well give you one while I'm here.
Thank you.
Oh, a kiss instead of money?
Hey, listen, come on.
He's a special friend.
Yeah, that's true.
You're special.
Right.
Okay, item number four, from the Administrative Office, adopt a proclamation recognizing the Calaveras County Fair and Jumping Frog Jubilee, May 19th through the 22nd, 2016.
I'd like to ask for the board's indulgence just for a moment so we can take care of some business. I'm Lori Giannini, and I'm the CEO of the Calaveras County Fairgrounds. And over 30 years ago, our board of directors started recognizing individuals who made significant contributions to both the association as a whole and to the Calaveras County Fair. And this year, and they call it the Honor Roll, and this year they enrolled Supervisor Ponte as one of those. For her, I didn't know I was going to do this. excuse me. Significant contributions to the fair. Here, just take the plaque. Councilman, as a supervisor, as a friend, and most recently in our response to Frogtown's response to the Butte Fire, her selfless, quiet determination and just being there hour after hour and saying from the first moment, Lori, I'm your friend, show me a phone. And she did amazing work for days on days with really just unselfish, amazing work. So congratulations, Debbie.
Thank you.
Supervisor Edson,
yes.
I think we need to pick the mic up.
Sure.
I know that's a new
new procedure.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, so today I have the pleasure of giving out this proclamation recognizing the Calaveras County Fair and Jumping Frog Jubilee, May 19th through the 22nd, 2016. Whereas the Calaveras County Fair and Jumping Frog Jubilee, May 19th through the 22nd, 2016, whose history dates back to the 1880s when wagon wheels roamed our roads and Mark Twain first penned the celebrated Jumping Frog of Calaveras County. And whereas the Calaveras County Fair and Jumping Frog Jubilee is a countywide event with an annual attendance exceeding 37,000. And whereas the Calaveras County Fair and Jumping Frog Jubilee encourages agriculture production and education, local arts, encourages youth, and highlights the best in Calaveras County. And whereas the theme of this year's event is boots, chaps, and cowboy hats, acknowledging the contributions of pioneer ranching families within the county. And whereas this year's celebration marks the 30th anniversary of the world record broken by Rosie the Riveter in 1986. And therefore it be resolved that the Calaveras County Board of Supervisors proclaims the Calaveras County Fair and Jumping Frog Jubilee to be the signature event in Calaveras County. And before I ask for the board's vote on this, I would like to thank Lori
because she has revived our county fair. And so, you know, I think that you may not know this, but I think that a lot of people recognize it. And this is a really huge event in our county, and I don't think it could be possible without you. So thank you.
Well, that's very sweet, but it really is. I get a lot of credit sometimes for what my community does, and it is really a team effort, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you.
That is true. We can't do nothing ourselves, but somebody needs to lead, right? And that's what you do.
Thank you.
So can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
So a motion by Supervisor Kearney.
Second.
Second by Supervisor Ponte. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
And passed and adopted by the Board of Supervisors of the County of Calaveras, State of California, this 10th day of May 2016. Here you go. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll be back at noon to jump frogs.
I know you will. Yeah, thank you, Dave. Public comments, please.
Hi, Deborah Mullen from Public Works.
Just hit the top button.
You got a call there. Yeah.
There you go. Thank you.
Calaveras Transit is going to be providing a shuttle service to the fair. This year it's going to be free on Saturday from, it's going to be going back and forth pretty much every 20, 30 minutes from the Angels Camp Transfer Center. That's the stop in front of Safe Mart, back and forth to the fair. And also from La Quintana Plaza, Valley Springs, San Andreas, and then also this year new Arnold via Big Trees Market and in front of the Arnold Library. And then the shuttle will be free also going back and forth from Angels Thursday and Friday as well. So we encourage you to leave your cars in a lot or at home if you can and take transit to the fair, and we'll see you there.
So, you know, it's a generous contribution, and you know, the more people we can get at this fair, the more successful it can be, and we, you know, I know you've continued to build that success for at least, how many years have you been doing this?
Some capacity since about 1990, but I was only five.
So there you go.
I've been the CEO since 2011 in the fall. So
there you go. So, and I remember it died off quite a while, and then Lori came along and has been reviving it ever since. So
thank you.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you. And we'll see you at noon.
Yes,
thank you.
During the public comment period, California law prohibits the board from taking action on any matter which is not posted on the agenda unless it's determined to be an emergency by the Board of Supervisors. If public comment is completed before the 30-minute allotted time period, the board may immediately move to regular agenda. Public comment, please.
Good morning, Marty Crane. I just love it when our community, when we highlight those that help our community come together and we share the spotlight. Thank you, Debbie. Thank you, Lori. Thank you, the team. Thank you, all the community effort that goes into making all these things happen. And sometimes I think we forget about one specific aspect of where our community must come together. We're coming up on a primary election, followed by the November election. And so many times we forget that this is a job interview. We have posted the job, we have identified the applicants, and now it is our job as every single American living in this county and beyond, to get to know those candidates, interview them, ask probing questions. Don't stop with the soundbite. Ask more questions, because the soundbite doesn't tell you what they know, how they feel about things. It's imperative that you know. And if you've decided early on who your person is, that's okay. But unless you have done your due diligence and sought out each and every candidate and had that conversation with them, with the intent of gaining the information that you absolutely must have to make an informed vote, then you are shorting yourself and the county and your efforts here. Now, this is our county, this is our business, and we are electing or we are hiring people to run the day-to-day operations of our business. We need to make sure that they have leadership expertise, that they have some leadership skills, that they have an inclusive mindset, and a passion for the job, and know what the job is before they apply. That being said, I want to make sure that every single person knows that there are three districts that are being challenged, but two districts are up for election, District 1 and District 4. And there are not one, not two, but three candidates or three applicants for these jobs, these two jobs, running for consideration. So please know that there are three, and until you have interviewed all three or sought out a variety information from a variety of places, we have failed to do our job as the employer who is going to pay a nice salary with full benefits. We have failed to do our job as the employer in the interview process. So please know that I know that the mail-in ballots, absentee ballots, have already gone out. That doesn't mean that you have to fill them out today. You can walk them into the polls on the election day. That just gives you time to do your investigative research. So go team. Thanks for pulling the communities together. And this is one more aspect where we can step up and have an impact. Thank you.
Okay. Any other public comments?
My name is George Fry. I'd like to talk about the election too. I went to a debate last week here at the town hall. I was disappointed in the debate itself. There weren't any really probing questions. We have two supervisors that have served before. It's interesting to me that each one of those supervisors couldn't get two other people on board during their 4 years to get the general plan done. To me, that's a sad commentary. There was a couple of things that went on afterwards. I wasn't wearing the pin of one of the candidates, of the two previous candidates. And one person was upset with me because I didn't wear that pin. And so she stomped off with her little group of people who were supporting one of the candidates. And so I walked over to her and I told her, I said, you know, this is a free country and people can vote for whoever they want to. And I happen to believe in this person, and I've known her a long, long time. And I'm going to vote for this person. I'm disappointed in the person that was on the board 8 years ago. That person decided to take into his own self a group of people, a small group, but it was 8 or 10, in private, and developed their own Valley Springs plan. general plan. Why would anybody leave the other 4,000 people out of the plan? And this same person, when it came time for the board agenda item to give the public works director a $17,000 raise, that person and two other persons agreed to do that. And that public works director extorted that money from him. And those three people are not on the board any longer. All three of them did not get reelected, and one of them is running again. So I hope that democracy works again and that people who don't follow the rules, if they're going to give $17,000, why don't they give it to all of the employees? And by the way, the public works director left shortly after that. And I bet that when he went to his new assignment, he said, this is my wage now, and I would like to have a 5 or 10% increase. The three people who voted for the $17,000 increase, if they have any conscience at all, they got to have mud on their face. In this district, which I will be voting for the first time in my life, because I've lived in other districts, I am proud to say that I'm going to be voting for Sharon Romano. And I'm going to be voting for her, even though she doesn't own a business in town. But this lady is very knowledgeable. She was an executive secretary, Sheila Packard.
30 seconds.
Now, I think that's the person that, even though she didn't run a local business here, she has done a tremendous amount of work helping people, being on the Commission on Aging, being on the Arts Council, doing websites for people, many of them at no charge. So I hope that you will be with me. We have two people that have already shown what they could do.
Thank you, George.
My name is Peter Race from Jenny Lynn. Can you hear me fine? Thank you. Long as campaign time, good. And as long as we're going down to memory lanes, there are some candidates out there, folks, that maybe it's a good time to remind them all the achievements when they were on the board. I'm looking forward to some candidates to tell us one of the issues when we give a staff a raise. And my God, all the employees showed up who was responsible, came in, and show how they feel about that administrator. Most of you weren't here that day. But all the employees for Public Works were sitting back there and disclosed exactly, well, it wasn't the greatest character making the decision to give Public Works a raise. I'm looking forward to some, maybe those ex-supervisors gonna be coming up. Maybe explain to us what a great job they did. But FEMA, the biggest, well, how you could put it diplomatically, screw over of this county ever received from MIMER, and I only been coming here for about 10, 15 years to these board meetings. How many people got shafted by the three supervisors who had a little deal made over at Mr. Lundgren's office? Breaking Brown Act? But we can always get the details. I'm sure staff will have all the details of the Brown Act that they violated. And I'm sure the staff will have all the paperwork that took this county down road with FEMA. And I hope that you folks don't make the same mistake that was been there. So I'm looking forward to a campaign and a message to anybody who takes anybody's house signs. What comes around goes around, folks. What's good for the goose, good for the gender. Because we should not take anybody's house signs. I don't care if I agree with the candidate or not. That's not very polite or kosher. So I'm looking forward to the campaign. None of my candidates running, but on the other hand, folks, you all accepted or bestowed upon you, you are all my CSA 1 directors. So I have no hesitation to stick my nose into your campaign on behalf of CSA 1. And I don't have to be diplomatic, folks, but I don't want it at the expense of the general public. So I'm, unfortunately, I got a personality fault. I don't hold grudges, but I will get even. CSA 1, you've been on this board for so long, I haven't seen once a report of what CSA 1's doing, folks. You assume that job, your staff's making good money off CSA 1. Maybe they want to save money on a paper that should be disclosed. What CSA 1 is doing, where the money goes, who authorized what. CSA 1 accomplished great things. They can clean a creek for $18,000. And I'm sure with all the social leeches that are around in this county, FEMA, fishing game, you name it, ABC. How did you able to clean a creek for $18,000 and a couple of months later? Does anybody know how much it costs to clean that creek in District 1? Maybe it needs some reminder, folks. Dig up some of that old things that have been buried quietly. I'm sure your staff will be able to provide the paperwork for all the approval you need to clean creeks. How much did it cost to clean that creek in District 1? We're looking forward to some good times, folks. Thank you.
Good morning. Al Segala, Taxpayer Association. Couldn't help the opportunity to comment on the election and also to comment on the purpose of government. That's not talked about very much anymore, but it'd be good to bear in mind what we look to government for. We don't look to government to take care of us. We need to take care of ourselves in a free society. Throughout human history, mankind has been mostly enslaved. And it's only in the last few hundred years, and then a couple flashes in history around the beginning of Greece and the beginning of Rome, where individuals were considered to have natural rights that could be respected. And systems of government and courts were established to recognize and protect that. We got such a blessing in our country that I doubt many people really realize how much a blessing it is. And that's our form of government, the U.S. Constitutional Republic. It's a limited government. It's not there to control the people, rule the people, or enslave the people. It's simply there to protect the natural rights that people have, which raises the question, what are these rights? Do we have a right to free medicine? Maybe free education? Maybe free schooling? Maybe free clothing, maybe free housing, maybe free food. Uh-oh, we're getting off track there a little bit. Our natural rights are to life, liberty, and property. Incidentally, pursuit of happiness is in that category, but at that time, property could not be used without maybe even not having a country to begin with, because at that time, the slave trade was very controversial. And Jefferson had the foresight not to use property in the Declaration of Independence, but to use pursuit of happiness instead. But if you look at all the writings of the three basic rights, even in the Constitution, life, liberty, and property. Life, liberty, and property. It's in the Fifth Amendment. It's in the 14th Amendment. And its theme is throughout the Constitution. So, if this is truly a good idea, which apparently it is a good idea and has been a good idea because the results have been great. We've had people coming to the United States from all over the world escaping governments that do not recognize individual rights. So, as we, now we're going in a time of a government expansion which has been slow and hard to reverse. We need to start to reverse the government expansion. We need to provide an atmosphere where people can live and work and create in security and safety. So the purpose of government is to protect those three rights, not to oppress them. We have so many laws now that it's almost like a can of worms. What do you do with a can of worms? There might be something here to give an example of that. This is a can, and these are worms. They're not real. And we are creating this can of worms, one worm at a time. We need to stop and ask ourselves the question, does government have to do this? Does government really have to do this? If we just ask that question, I think you'll find that a lot of the things that have been passed, not only in local government, but in state government and federal government, state government is next worst, and then the local government is probably the best of government in recognizing individual rights. It could be because you're closer to the people.
30 seconds.
And because you're closer to the people, it's easy to replace supervisors. Really hard to replace at the higher levels of government. So, as we go into the election, forget about personalities. Think in terms of, does this candidate recognize the Constitution, understand the basic rights of people? If the answer is no, don't vote for him. If the answer is yes, well, that'd be a good person to vote for. Thank you.
Any other public comments? We got some frogs out there at lunch for the worms. No,
these are fishing worms.
All right, so I think we're ready to do number three. So we can move on to our regular agenda.
Okay, item number six is adopt a resolution appointing Rick DiBasilio to the position of sheriff.
Okay. Good morning, Judy Hawkins, Human Resources and Risk Director. And this is the resolution memorializing the appointment of Rick DiBasilio to the position of sheriff.
Okay. Where is it?
And so... So do you want me to read through the whole thing, or do we want to just go ahead and vote on the appointment?
Okay. Go ahead.
Okay. So our summary here in, in 2014, Sheriff Gary Koontz was elected to a second term of office. After serving over 10 months of his second term, he unfortunately and unexpectedly passed away in October 2015, creating a vacancy in the office of sheriff. In accordance with Government Code 25304, the Board of Supervisors shall fill by appointment all vacancies that occur in any office filled by the appointment of the board and elective county officers, except judge of the Superior Court and supervisors. The appointee shall hold office for the unexpired term or until the first Monday after January 1st, succeeding the next general election. According to the California Supreme Court and numerous Attorney General opinions, the next general election described in 25304 means the next gubernatorial election. On May 2, 2016, the Board of Supervisors conducted public interviews for purposes of selecting an appointee. After deliberations, the Board approved appointing Rick DeVasilio to the position of sheriff. Approval of the attached resolution memorializes this action. This appointment is effective Tuesday, May 2, 2016, and Sheriff DeVasilio will serve as sheriff until the position is filled at the 2018 gubernatorial election.
Okay. And so do we have a hard copy of this that we're going to be able to give Sheriff DeVasilio?
We, in the past, we have not done resolutions. I assume Supervisor Etchen, you're talking about one like we do with the proclamations. In the past, for appointment of positions, we have not done that. However, upon approval of this resolution that's attached in the board packet, we can make one up on special paper for Sheriff DeVasilio.
I mean,
and then it can be presented at his formal swearing in on Thursday.
That'd be good. All right, so could I have public comments, please?
I'm Peter Race Jenilin. I realize it was a hard decision to make. I don't envy you folks, you got my sympathy. You made the decision. I would be nice if the, whoever is the sheriff right now would introduce himself to the public a little bit more openly over here. I would love to hear from him, what he stands for, what he's willing to do, and so on. So if, I don't know if it's a proper time to ask him to come up and say something, but if he's not available or capable of doing it today, I would like to hope schedule him in a very near future. I'd like to see what it stands for and what you folks picked out as the second highest police or law enforcement agency. I'm sure there's going to be some debate between a DA and him, but I would like to get to know him a little bit, see what he has to say. Thank
right.
you.
Why don't we do that?
I think you may get your wish.
Come on up here, Sheriff DeVasilio. Sheriff DeVasilio.
Hi, Peter. I'm Sheriff DeVasilio.
Oh, nice to meet you. You're the guy who rescued that court, huh?
So you got your wish there, Mr. Race.
See, Peter, if you pay a little more attention during the board meetings, you know that I was the sheriff because I was here that day as you were when they voted me in.
I should come more often.
You should come more often, or at least when you show up, pay attention.
I come as often as I can.
How many times have I sat over there? And you never knew.
That's right.
Well, I'm glad you know.
He should come on the days the doors are locked today.
There you go. So I'm Rick DeVasilio. I am your new sheriff. Mr. Sigali was talking about the Constitution. That's what I'm here for, is to uphold the Constitution for the people of the state of California, or for the county of Calaveras. We have some things that we're going to be dealing with this afternoon. If you want to see me speak and I can introduce myself to you again this afternoon, you're more than welcome to come back. And I'm sure you'll be here.
Thank you. I hope you keep seeing it once from now.
And I will. I've been in this county since 1978. I've been around a while. I don't plan on going anywhere. This is my home, as it is a lot of folks in this room and in the public. So my intent is to move this county in a forward direction, make the Sheriff's Department better than what it is, not that it's bad, but just to make it better, to continue to move forward, and to continue to help the citizens of this county. That's what it's all about. Citizens are number one. You guys are the priority. Gary Kuntz had the best motto in the world, community first, and I still stand by that motto. So we'll move forward. And it was good to meet you, Peter. I'm not used to that yet.
All right. any other public comments?
Al Sagat, Taxpayer Association, you're so welcome, and we appreciate your support of the Constitution. And also, you're invited to be on our Taxpayer TV program on Public Access TV, and be able to meet more people.
We'll look forward to that.
Well, excuse me. Well, Rick, you know that I have supported you, and that I'm really happy that you're the sheriff. I'm really happy that four of the board members voted for you, and that they supported you, and that they supported what they said they would do, and that was they would go down the rank and file, and if somebody in the sheriff's office stepped up in the rank and file, that they would support them, would support that person. I am very happy that you're on board. You have one heck of a reputation with kids who are now in upper grades, and some of them have graduated, and they still know you as Officer Rick. And you have left a lifetime impression on them with in the way you have modeled them with parents who are not doing the modeling. And so I thank you very much, and I congratulate you for being our sheriff. And I know that Gary, who was mentoring you, has got to be happy. Thank you.
Kaz Tomaszewski, Executive Director of the Calaveras Cannabis Alliance. Sheriff DiBasilio was quoted recently in the paper as preferring a ban for cannabis, so it might be weird that I'm up here talking right now, but I do not blame any law enforcement person for wanting that. I know that law enforcement sees the very worst of cannabis, that they have very good reasons for being reticent and wary of it. The only thing that we want to see from our law enforcement is taking the time to figure out who the good guys are and the bad guys are, and giving people the benefit of the doubt and being respectful in conversation. In my experience, Sheriff DiBasilio has always done that. Even long before he was appointed sheriff, in our conversations, he mentioned during the interview process that he approaches everyone, talks to them as if they are a brother or sister, no matter who they are. And I can tell you from a group that a lot of law enforcement people have reasons to be frustrated with that is true. And so from a group that is part of a very intense political process right now in a county that is currently discussing what to do with us, I am very happy and confident that you are the new sheriff because of the respect that you've shown us in conversations. And I just want to make sure that you know that, and everyone in this room does as well. Thank you.
Good morning. Vicki Reinke, Calaveras County Republicans. We want to congratulate you on your appointment to sheriff. We're excited that we have a constitutional sheriff in our county, and we want you to know that we're behind you 100%. So thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Okay, seeing none, may I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second. So I have a motion by Supervisor Olivera, second by Supervisor Wright, to adopt this resolution. Recognize Sheriff DiBasilio and appoint. He's ready to appoint.
I have. I sent the paperwork.
Yeah, he did.
Good.
He got sworn in.
Good.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? 5-0. Thank you, sir.
Might not have voted for me that day. He still supports me, and I appreciate his support. I really do.
Mr. Chair, could I take a moment for a comment?
Sure.
I'd like to publicly recognize my personal thanks
to Captain Jim Macedo. For leading our county and sheriff's department through some very trying times. Sacrifices made by him and that department and all of our public agencies were beyond the call of duty. And I want to thank him.
I'd just like to make a quick note that because of the work that Captain Macedo has done in the department for all the years that I've been there and the support that he's given me, he will be the one swearing me in on Thursday.
On to our next regular agenda item.
Item number seven, the Environmental Management Agency, adopt a resolution authorizing the submittal of the draft of Local Agency Management Plan, LAMP, to the Central Valley Regional Water Quality Control Board for local oversight on the on-site wastewater treatment systems program within Calaveras County.
Well, good morning, Board of Supervisors. Wait for the there's a projector to turn on here. Jason Bateser, Calaveras County Environmental Management Agency Administrator. Next to me is Matt Poole, Registered Environmental Health Specialist and our lone on-site inspector for the on-site wastewater department. We're here before you this morning to discuss AB 885, I'll get into that, and our local on-site wastewater program and the proposal for submittal to the Regional Water Quality Control Board of our local agency management plan, which will be in part of our current ordinance and regulations for Calaveras County. Calaveras County On-Site Wastewater Department is one of five departments under Environmental Management Agency. Approximately three-quarters of the homes in Calaveras County are served with on-site wastewater systems. So it's just a basic diagram depicting on-site wastewater system for those that may not know, but I think most of us do. But our human waste and wastewater flows into a septic tank and into the leach field for treatment to protect not only surface water but groundwater, ensure proper treatment. Currently, as I stated, is department on-site wastewater department came to Environmental Management Agency back in 2009, and we had three inspectors for the department. With the recession and retirement, we're down to one inspector and one permit tech. We backfill in that program with staff from Environmental Health Department. But just to give you an update, we're seeing a trend over the last 2 years of an increase of number of permit fees within the on-site wastewater department. In part, we're seeing more development, and also we've seen an increase in the last month or two also with the recovery of the Butte Fire. But Matt and staff do an excellent job of maintaining a good service to the people and to the contractors that are installing the systems. Currently, the systems are installed under Calaveras County Ordinance Title 13. They were put together back in 1980. I was eight at that time. And the rules and regulations were adopted by the board in 92. So the county has a long history of permitting the systems, but with recognizing that the county recognized in order to make sure that we did not have wastewater effluent contaminating our surface waters and or groundwaters, was proactive in developing a plan. Background, a little bit of water quality regulation in the state of California. We have the State Water Board as the parent organization, And underneath the State Water Board, there's 9 regional boards. Within those regional boards, there's basin plans. And those basin plans are based on the geography in that region, looking at geology, topography, watershed, and those specific plans are specific to each region. And then those regional boards also require waste discharge permits or requirements, and for certain types of discharges of wastewater or stormwater based on usage. And with that will be permit requirements, and then some of those uses are conditional waiver. And I go through this because if we get into the AB 885 and the state policy for on-site wastewater, and the direction that we're recommending to the Board of Supervisors is that under that policy that there will be a conditional waiver for individual private property owners for their on-site septic system. We'll get into that. So AB 885 was signed into law in 2000, and this was added primarily due to the Southern California, and I'll get into that in a second, but the key part of this, it added a section to the California Water Code in that the board, in consultation with Department of Public Health, California Conference of Directors of Environmental Health, state and local agencies, and RCRC, shall adopt regulations or standards for the permitting and operation of on-site sewage treatment systems. So it gave some flexibility to the legislation to the regional board. But the original, whether to adopt regulations and standards, the board, State Water Board, went forward, tried to adopt regulations, get into that. But now we're at the point where they adopted a policy and more flexible standards. So again, the bill was focused around for Southern California. City of Malibu was all on on-site wastewater treatment systems. At the time, it was a way of Malibu not becoming Miami West, with having the on-site systems. And there was a lot of nutrient impact to waterways in Southern California. And in the original bill, they had the term coastal zone. Well, what they did is they removed that and made it for statewide. And that initially created a problem because they're trying to create statewide regulations and standards based on issues in Southern California for the impaired water bodies. And we all know that the geology is not the same throughout the state of California. Local agencies, as I mentioned earlier, have been implementing this program long before the state board ever developed regulations and standards. And so through the process, it really in 2005, 2011, there was over 2,500 comments submitted to the state board based on the original regulations. And finally in 2011, there was a change to the person that was leading this charge for the state board, and the state realized that they needed more collaboration with RCRC, local agencies, directors of environmental health, to develop a flexible regulation where local agencies have already been implementing these programs. So that was a good thing, but refer to kind of Al's scenario before with the can of worms. This is something where the state started with a can of worms, not knowing what direction they're quite going in. But so what happened is in 2011, with input from local agencies, RCRC, the board adopted a policy in June of 2012, and this policy became effective in May 2013. And that sets the kind of the standards of where what we'll be explaining to you today. State board objectives after that in 2011 was to obviously satisfy the statutory requirements of AB 885. Protect the beneficial uses of the water for both public health and environmental protection. Create a framework for local agencies. They understood that, we've been permitting these systems for a long time. Most local agencies have. The issues that AB 885 initially were centered around were for the coastal areas, but the state of California also recognized they needed to have statewide standards. At the time, California was, believe it or not, only one of two states in the United States that did not have statewide standards for on-site wastewater treatment systems. Manage wastewater systems, on-site wastewater systems going forward, and dealing with existing systems where problems are proven. So in those areas where there's impaired water bodies designated by the regional board, also not requiring retroactive requirements for those systems that are already installed for private property owners. They finally understood that we're not going to create the perfect policy right away, but let's create a framework that allows local agencies to move forward, and then there's time, five-year time frames, where this policy can be adjusted for the local jurisdiction and for the state. And again, address those impaired water bodies where septic systems are known contributors to the nutrient load in those water bodies. So that left us that the state created five tiers, and the first one is tier zero, and this is for existing on-site wastewater systems. So this is where they're functioning properly, they've been permitted by the local agency, and therefore there's no waste discharge permit required for these systems. So these are already existing systems, less than 10,000 gallons per day or less, in which that doesn't even, the 10,000 gallon is a high mark. On-site private property ones don't even come close to that amount. Tier one is new or replaced systems, and this is for if a local agency does not move forward with a tier two. So if a local agency does not have their own rules and regulations, does not enter into a local agency management plan with the regional board, the requirements must fall back to the tier one standards, and these standards are set forth by the state of California. They're more prescriptive and then local standards. Tier two is what we're recommending today before the board to submit a draft to local agency, our local agency management plan, LAMP, to the regional board. And this allows us to use our existing ordinance, rules and regulations that look at our geology within Calaveras County, and preserve our current policy and practices, but yet still be protective of water resources. And I say that because Calaveras County does not have any designated impaired water bodies at this point in time. Tuolumne County does, with the Woods Creek area, and that housing development around there has been known to be a contributor to that water body, and they would fall under the tier three. So staff and the original development of the rules and regulations, I know Brian Moss, the former director, I think the rules and regs were updated 6 years ago, has stayed up to date with technology and practices and working with industry to have good systems that treat our waste that's generated on private properties. Tier three, this is for those areas that have impaired water bodies designated by the Regional Water Quality Control Board. So Calaveras County does not fall into this category. And tier four is the last of the tiers, and this is for failing on-site wastewater treatment systems. This just means that if there's a failing system, once either it would have to go into a tier two if you have a LAMP with the regional board, or into a tier one into the state's requirements. Because a failing system would need a waste discharge permit, but our staff is very proactive in ensuring that public health is protected and that those systems are repaired as quickly as possible, and also interim measures are put in place so we don't have effluent impacting public health and or the environment. If an on-site wastewater system does not conform to any of the tiers, the owner, private property owner, may be required to submit a report of waste discharge to the regional board for permit requirements. We're not recommending that today, but that is where how it falls into the regional board regulatory structure. So is the local agency management plan right for Calaveras County? Just wanted to break it down, kind of show the differences between Tier 1, and it's in summary what I've already said, but Tier 1, more prescriptive requirements. We have reduced local control. There's monitoring, reporting requirements, as is there is in Tier 2, and no standard approval process in Tier 1. Tier 2, we get to retain our current rules and regulations and ordinance. There will be some additional monitoring, annual monitoring, and five-year monitoring reports that are going to be due to the regional board. And we also have to go through the approval process, and we're going to talk about here in a little bit. But our application and processing time for local contractors, private property owners, stays the same as if we submit the LAMP under Tier 2. So Matt and primarily has been working feverishly besides the runaround to perform inspections on developing the LAMP for the county. The provisions, we're trying to make it to be as consistent with our existing rules and regulations. Regional board will consider programs that differ from their prescriptive requirements based on justification from what we submit to the regional board. The LAMP includes provisions for water quality protection. And this is where we're able to use, in the beginning of AB 8.5, they were talking about there was fear that it was going to require individual domestic well testing for private property owners. That is no longer the case. We're able to do an environmental health department. We're also the agency that permits small public water systems. And with that, we permit about 46 public water systems, which have about 75 sample points throughout the county. We're able to use this data because they test for bacteria, nitrates annually or quarterly, depending on type of the system, and use this data to meet other state requirements. And we're also asking that, since we already submit this data to a different state agency under the State Water Board, that they share their information so we're not re-reporting that information to the same agency for a different purpose. So we're trying to consolidate our reports and what we're already doing within other departments in the Environmental Management Agency. Annual report, as I mentioned before, is required under Tier 2. We'll have to report to the regional board on 5 years on changes needed to the LAMP based on, you know, whether it's technology updates, you know, geology, whatever it may be, state requirements. And then after the submittal process, which I'll get into, is once the regional board reviews our draft LAMP, they may come back to us for potential amendments. So timeline for Tier 2 development, we submit the LAMP to the regional board. Regional board has 90 days to review local agency management plans. It may be longer. I was talking to a representative yesterday. But all said, when it's all said and done, it's we will have time to comment back or refute the comments from the regional board to the state water board. We can appeal those if we desire, but the whole process and implementation has to be completed by May 2018. During this time frame, so where we're at is we're recommending the board to adopt the resolution authorizing Environmental Management Agency to submit the draft LAMP to the regional board for review. After we receive comments back, it's the agency is going to hold workshops with our regulated community and public, with contractors, consultants, to go over those amendments that are proposed by the regional board, and then we will return back to the Board of Supervisors with the recommendations made from the regional board, hosting the workshop, and have a final LAMP to be submitted to the regional board for approval. And hopefully we can get that done by a 1 year period, and then that'll give the county a year of implementation for potential changes to the rules, regulations, and or ordinance. So that's a brief summary. It's kind of ironic that it's called the LAMP when the original bill was signed, you know, 16 years ago. It seemed like there was never going to be light out of the tunnel with this thing. There was a lot of controversy as this was first developed by the State Water Board. But I feel that with the Water Board, along working with RCRC and Directors of Environmental Health, have come a long way and have developed a flexible policy that allows us to do what we do best and have that local program. Any questions?
Yeah, I got a couple. You talked about the conditional waiver in the background.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain that a little bit more?
Yes, yeah, so by once the LAMP is approved, the Tier 2 by Regional Board, the individual property, it grants a conditional waiver for all existing systems and all new systems going forward for individual on-site wastewater treatment systems.
And then that kind of leads into the question of the Tier 2 LAMP. There's additional monitoring and reporting that's listed as a bullet item here. Does that... how will that play out on the ground with landowners? Will that be new or existing, or is there any added monitoring once the LAMP is approved, or how does that work?
Right now, for the monitoring that we're moving forward is with using our data for the small public water systems. We also have data that on individual domestic wells, and before the well can be finaled, they have to do a back T nitrate sample. That's one-time data that we may be able to use. But I'm trying to talk in other counties, have the state use the data that they already have. You know, any more reporting requirements on us is gonna be more staff time and cost. As far as reporting for the individual on-site wastewater systems, standard systems, engineered, it doesn't look at this time, but alternative systems, which are in our rules and regulations, may require some additional monitoring for those types of systems.
But the regular septic?
Regular system, no impact. Yeah.
What other alternative systems?
Alternative systems, Matt, I'll let you explain that you can.
Well, the rules and regs address, according to certain site and soil conditions, require certain types of engineered systems. In some instances, we have to use pre-treatment, which is like a textile filter or a sand filter. So in some of those pre-treatment type units, the state might require some additional or annual monitoring to make sure those systems are working correctly.
At this point in time, we did not put in our draft plan any additional monitoring for the systems. We don't have any data that's at this point in time that says that those systems are impairing groundwater or water bodies. But so this is something that will be vetted out through the process with the regional board and then working with our regulated community and then bringing back to the Board of Supervisors for final approval.
And then I got one more for you. 46, is that what you said? Small public water systems. So what's the definition of a small public water system?
Small public water systems are those systems of 15 or more connections, but less than 200 connections. In there's also state small and CERFL systems or CalCode systems. They don't meet the definition of a small public water system, but they have some additional monitoring requirements. An example would be the cafe up in Mount Ranch that has its own well. They have to do annual testing for back T and nitrates.
So they don't fall into the small...
They fall into that category. They fall into a CalCode category, but they just don't meet the state's small definition of 15 to 200 connections.
Right.
And then anything greater than 200 connections like CCWD was regulated by the California Department of Public Health. Since then, they moved that about a year ago, that division, under the State Water Board, and that's where the regional boards are also under the State Water Board, and I'm asking them to share the information that they already have from our drinking water program, since they have that program now, and ironically, it's under the Department of Finance under the State Water Board, so.
Thank you for clarifying.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Any questions? Sure, I have a question. Mr. Bozer, as a point of clarification, in District 3, we are mostly septic up in the Lake Springs area in our developments. How does that affect, and I know we're talking about individual groundwater treatment systems, septic tank systems. How does that affect LAMP? How does that affect those people, if it affects them at all? Especially when they want to maybe sell their property?
As far as...
program?
Yeah, yeah. If the system is functioning properly, there's no additional requirements. So there's no additional requirements. If they're going to install the system, there's certain areas up in Big Trees Village that's already required to be engineered based on a regional board resolution. So at this point in time, for instance, there may be some slopes. One of the criteria is the Tier 1 prescriptive requirements. The state doesn't want to allow septic systems installed on slopes greater than 30%. Our current rules and regulations allow systems to be installed, engineered up to 40%. One of the ways that the state gets by with this is having a slope stability report to be submitted with the design of that new system. So mind you, that's not all parcels, but that could impact some of those parcels up the Highway 4 corridor that are on steeper slopes. And we've had repairs where systems failed on steep slopes, and there's no other spot to put them in but on that existing slope, so we're stuck with it. So as we go through this process, as of right now, there's no additional requirements. And it's a matter of kind of submitting this draft to the regional board and using our existing rules and regulations, which are very comprehensive, and having them go back and hopefully see our justifications in there, where there will not be a lot of added changes to those rules and regulations. But again, that's why we'll be working with the regulated community and bringing back those recommendations to the board for final approval.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Jason, on this time frame here, so when we submit the LAMP, are you saying you think it's going to take about a year before it comes back to this board for final approval?
I'm hoping. Talking to the regional board yesterday, we're not. People have to have them submitted by the end of this week. This snuck up on us, and I'm sorry I'm here right now, but we're here with the fire and everything. And but they're also, Tuolumne County is just submitting theirs this week, along with Amador and everybody else's. So the goal is they have 90 days, said may need more. I'm hoping to be back this fall with a final approval to the board. I don't want to be going into next spring. And that gives us more time than if we have to amend our ordinance and or rules and regulations, and longer for implementation, a grace period in letting private property owners know if there may be changes, and also the regulated community in performing that outreach.
So what you're submitting right now is currently what we're doing right now.
Exactly.
So when the state board comes back to us, they may want us to modify, adjust, whatever.
There may be some modifications and adjustments. And, you know, I hate to speculate what those are until, you know, the slope is one of them that we discussed. So once we get their comments back, and that was the whole thing, too, with the Tier 2, is that the state did realize, and I talked to Plumas County, and they're in the central region, is that when they just got back some comments from the regional board, and that the regional board understands that every local jurisdiction is different, the geology is different, the topography is different, and if you have, you know, we have extensive rules and regulations that have been adopted by the board, where some counties just have an ordinance and they're operating more on policy, where our rules and regulations are a policy and are formally adopted. So that, mm-hmm. to me, that gives us an advantage as we submit the LAMP to the regional board.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So as you move forward with this process and you start having those public meetings, will you please inform the board?
Yes. Back, yeah.
So we can show up.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments from the board? Questions? Any public comments?
Al Segala, Taxpayer Association. Thank you for an excellent presentation. The question that we would have is similar to what Chris asked, is what do you see as the effect on people's ability to build and put in septic systems? Are we moving into tighter regulation, or are we moving into more flexible regulation? I'm not quite sure the direction's happening here.
We're submitting our current rules and regulations as they are. So I wouldn't say more flexible There is the potential with some of the prescriptive requirements on the state, for instance, one of the requirements is they want to have effective soil depth under the trench of 5 feet for standard systems. We have 3 feet. We have some good justification for that. So this is where the rubber meets the road, and we negotiate and explain why scientifically we feel our rules and regulations meet the standards to protect. And again, it's not a matter of their standards, you know, show that our standards are good enough to protect public health, you know, groundwater and surface waters of the state. So, you know, at this point in time, it's status quo. Until we get comments back from the regional board on, there's, I think Matt highlighted maybe 8 different areas of going through our rules and regulations versus the state prescriptive regulations where there's some differences.
Right.
And so it's a matter of how we work through that process.
It would seem like the 5-foot excavation versus the 3-foot excavation would be a substantial increase in cost of the system, because I assume that it's going to require more drain rock and plus the excavating time.
Yeah, it was actually, they want effective soil depth to put a standard system in from 3, they want 5 feet of soil versus 3 feet. That's a difference, not the installation of that trench.
I see.
So that, those are the design siting requirements that we'll be working with the regional board and explaining to them. They're not familiar with our geology.
Yeah.
Well, they may be, obviously. I should say they're not. But again, here's where they, this was the tier, that was the tier one standard. So if the county decided not to go submit a LAMP, this is what would be, that's what would the requirements would be. So therefore, by submitting the LAMP, that we're able to show them what our rules and regulations are, how we've been protective of groundwater and surface water, and go through that process so we can continue moving in the same fashion that we are.
Do you have, or is there in existence, an organization of local engineers and contractors that are actually doing this work that can have input? Is that happening?
Yeah, we didn't, but we're going to be moving forward because the draft was our existing rules and regulations. And as in the past, when the rules and regulations were updated, I know Brian has included the contractors and consultants. Matt prepares newsletters that go out to the contractors and consultants of, you know, things that are happening in the on-site wastewater program, because it impacts not only so many private property owners,
right,
but also so many contractors. So this will be a process that is definitely will be engaging. We have a list of all the contractors and engineers in the county. We'll be having a workshop for the public and going through that process.
Well, it looks like we have a case of good government. Thank you.
Well, part of that too is disclosing to the realtors and real estate folks the effects it would have on a property, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because I know you guys have been doing that for quite a while.
Yeah.
But in the valley, I mean, it's no problem getting a 5-foot soil depth, you know. And around here, you're going to hit 2 feet and then 10 feet of rock. So, you know, so that's the difference, I think, like you're talking about the geology.
Yeah.
So. Hmm. Okay. Peter?
Yes. Peter Reyes, gentlemen. I love the government at work. 2000 has started. Sarcastic question. Did any of these state water board, regional water boards, basin plans, waste discharge requirement, condition waiver, are they in existing, or do they have a full committee, or how many of them are busted by the feds lately for corruption? Okay. I'm going to put you in a spot. Here we're going. One of the things that, and I'm glad that we can bring it down to local levels. Believe it or not, guys, I do trust you all. Okay, maybe I don't see face to face in certain times, but I do trust you all. You got to, 2018? That must be speed of light for these guys in Sacramento. From 2000 to, God, 2 years? Wow, I don't think they could function that fast. There's one little minor question I have, okay? Fine, they gotta justify their existence. But we don't have a general plan done yet. And we're going to have some building done pretty soon. And you got a whole bunch of different districts that's going to be affected. Are you coordinating, cooperating or something with the planning department? How does that might or might not affect whatever they plan to do, these high-density buildings? That's going to have some effect, your wastewater, getting rid of the wastewater. And eventually, if they're going to, we're going to, the county's going to be taking care of, take responsibility for it. Is the county as whole will be taking liability for it, or is each individual district will hold their responsibility and liability for if there's any, I don't think there will be, but if there's anything not quite kosher, who's going to take the liability on it? Is the whole county or just each particular district? Let's say CCW screws up, not that they would ever be, but if CCW screws up, and they are a pretty big waste disposals, is it going to affect the whole county or just CCWD?
So this
who's going to take the responsibility for all this administration?
First question with the planning department. Our department has coordinated with the current siting requirements for our new developments for on-site wastewater treatment systems, and that our current what we have now with the planning department is what we're proposing to the regional board. Second, as far as this is strictly for those on-site wastewater treatment systems for individual private property owners. The bigger treatment facilities for CCWD are outside the scope of this, of AB 885. This plan does not include municipal or publicly operated wastewater treatment systems.
So you're going to pick on a little guys, huh? Thank you.
Any other public comments? Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second.
So I have a motion by Supervisor Wright and a second by Supervisor Ponte to adopt a resolution authorizing the submittal of the draft local area management LAMP to the Central Valley Regional Water Quality Control Board for local oversight of the on-site wastewater treatment systems program within Calaveras County. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? 5-0.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for the good presentation.
Thank you.
That was good. I didn't realize we had that many small public water.
Yeah, I didn't either.
Yeah, it's kind of a shock. A lot.
I'm cooking hot dogs for Frog Jokes, so I'll be practicing my good public health practices. So.
We're going to take a 5-minute break while Jason and Emma are cleaning that up.
Okay.
5 minutes.
Item number 8, the Administrative Office, approve a proposal from the San Andreas Recreation and Park District to develop an 18-hole disc golf course at Alex Quiñones Community Park and approve the First Amendment to San Andreas Recreation and Park District Baseball Park lease to include disc golf as a recreational use.
Hi, good morning, Supervisors. Mary Rose Ruticanga with the Administrative Office. Before you, we have an item, a two-part item. We're asking you to approve the development of an 18-hole disc golf course. And the proposal is as attachment A in your board packet, and also to approve a First Amendment to the San Andreas Rec and Park District Baseball Park lease that we have with the county. The lease was entered into in 2005. The district is asking to develop the course within 4 phases, and it's detailed within that attachment A. Each phase describes both the construction and also improvements that are needed to fulfill the general ADA requirements in Title II. And then also, as I stated, the second part is to approve the amendment that designates disc golf as a recreational use in the lease and also addresses compliance with ADA law.
Okay, thank you. Can I have public comments, please? Jim, you want to talk on it?
Yeah, just please approve.
I'll make a motion to approve.
Okay. Second.
So I have a motion by Supervisor Wright, second by Supervisor Ponte. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? 5-0.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was a tough one.
Yeah. I mean, it took like 2 years to get to do a less than a 2 minute presentation,
that's
right?
We'll bring you guys all a disc when we're finished.
Wow. Oh, yeah. It looks great out there. I walked that all the time.
Fun stuff.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the wildflowers now are gorgeous.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, they are.
Nice addition.
Thank you, guys.
Okay. Item number 9 from the district attorney, authorize the district attorney to apply for Victim Services XC grant and authorize the chair to sign the certification of assurance of compliance.
Okay.
I don't see any representative from the district attorney's office. I don't know if you want to address the consent agenda and maybe return to this to give them time to come up from their offices to answer the board's questions on this subject.
Let's go with public comments.
Just look. May I or not?
Number 9.
Okay. It's occurred to me that I know you folks want to save money on paper, but you already have your staff sign it. Both attorneys and a CEO signed it. If they went through it and they approved it, why do we need the waste department heads come in here and explain it? You got the people who already approved it and know all about it, put their names to it. Why don't they just explain it? Wouldn't that save a whole bunch of money for the county? Thank you.
Oh, there she is.
Oh.
Let's keep on.
Sorry, I want to snap my pen, did I miss it?
Go ahead. It's all done, they're just waiting for public comment.
Oh.
To be over.
Go ahead, Barbara.
I apologize, I was watching the meeting, getting some work done at my desk, and I heard 8 and I started walking. I guess it was a lot faster than I thought it would be. I'm assuming that you've gone through this. I don't know. We haven't gone through it. You told me we're at public comment. Okay. this is the XC grant that we would like to apply for. It is a Cal OES grant. I learned of this grant through an email I received from Supervisor Oliveira. It is a pretty exciting opportunity for my office. Working with the group, the quite large group that makes up the mandatory VSSC, the Victim Services Steering Committee, my office was the logical place to build on our victim services that we currently have. We decided that the underserved population we have in Calaveras County right now is not necessarily what you would normally think of as an underserved population, but we do have a very identifiable need with our victims' next of kin. Those are the next of kin in our homicide cases. We refer to them as VNOCs. With our drastic increase in homicides, we have a drastic increase in our number of VNOCs. With our recent triple homicide, when we meet with the VNOCs in that case, we have to use the sheriff's office, their large community room. There is no place to gather such a large group of people. These people are all people in need. They've lost a loved one in shocking, violent circumstances, and they deserve respect. They deserve to be treated well. They deserve our attention, and that takes time and takes resources. The status of my office right now is limited in that regard, and we would like to do better. We would like to do better for the VNOCs, and the grant is an opportunity to do that. The other population we identified is children in high exposure and risk cases. And what I mean by that are children who have been victims themselves of crime, or perhaps their caregiver was, and the exposure in the case is a life crime. It's a 25 to life or 40 to life for the perpetrator. This can have devastating impacts on the child's life, because of the upheaval in the family. It's typically a family situation. Those cases take a lot of time, a lot of effort, and the victims, of course, deserve it. We're dealing with issues that are going to be ongoing in their lives. My office does our best to establish an ongoing relationship with the victims, because it doesn't just start and stop when they have to come to court, and we can help them through that process, but the impact on their lives is such that, once again, we'd like to do better. The other type of children we're talking about are teenagers who've had the guts to come forward. And what happens is social media kicks in, and there's victim shaming that goes around. You know, we'd like to be there for those victims. We had a case where we were very concerned that something devastating was going to happen in our young victim's life, and we dropped everything to rally around and to reach out to other family members to make sure that this victim was going to be okay. We don't want to have one of those situations where a victim has come forward, she gets victim shamed, and she ends up committing suicide. We do not want that to happen here. So, you know, we kind of pinpointed a few of the child victims that take that extra effort, and we think it's worth it. Now, I don't know if Supervisor Oliveira realized that there was a required county match when he sent me the information about the grant. And we know how the grants go. We know how the grants go. It looked like a large, large pot of money was available. This is a two-year grant, and the grant does break down what amounts are allocated for each county. Our county is eligible for only the $171,000 and some change. So it would be a very good service. I understand if you as a board can't necessarily commit to the $42,000 county match. It's $42,000 over 2 years. I don't know if that makes any better. I don't have any room in my budget. So we would like to expand if you're willing to support it. But obviously it's up to you. It comes down to dollars. I recognize that. We did seek to use the funding possibly just for the facility, because some of you have been to my office and you know there is no privacy, there is no appropriate place to have victims there. When we do meet with victims, even if it's a small group, we typically do that off-site somewhere else because of the lack of privacy and the lack of confidentiality we can afford them. So bringing in new personnel to deal with this very sensitive populations, the VNOCs and the children in high-risk cases, does require another facility. And it's just one of those things. So we did try to see if using the money for some hardscaping and to get a facility for the couple years, because we thought that would be a very good thing for victims, but the answer was no. So this is the best we could do. So if you have any questions specifically about what we would intend to do with the funding, should you agree to let us apply?
Any questions? A couple of quick questions. Yeah. Your audio. Are any services provided to the victim witness program that would provide and fill these needs existing right now in the program?
We do the best we can, but what you have to realize is we have one victim witness coordinator. We did receive funding for an advocate for this year. We are in the process of hiring someone, but we filed 1,400 cases a year. You know, and the coordinator that we have typically focuses on the domestic violence cases. We have another staff member who tries to intervene in the property crimes cases, but we just have too many cases. And these particular cases are so time intensive, and then they go on. That's the other part of it. They go on, and the best service would be to have somebody dedicated specifically to those caseloads, so they can develop those ongoing personal relationships. So we do service victims. We do help them through the process with the Victim Compensation Board applications. We do provide information on court dates, and we do provide court accompaniment as we can. But it's very limited with the staffing that we have, and you know, we've just had this huge influx of cases. The other small part of the grant that I'm actually very excited about is the ability to have a victim advocate respond to crime scenes with us. You know, we're only talking a few times a year, but my idea would be that if I'm sending out one of my deputies and an investigator or myself to a homicide scene, which, you know, the sheriff's office, once it's cleared and safe, they call us out for our assistance. I'd like to be able to bring an advocate with me. And that person could act as the liaison during the investigation and a single point of contact, and hopefully carry that through to the prosecution stage. We did that in one of our high-profile cases, and it worked very well. It worked very, very well to have that person there in the beginning stages with the victims and the victim's next of kin.
And you did state the $42,000 match provided by the county would be over a two-year period?
Yes.
And the grants for 2 years,
$171,000. It's a two-year period, yeah. Which is why I thought, you know, hardscaping might make more sense. You know, it's difficult to bring on somebody just for 2 years and then, you know, not know whether or not the grant is going to be continued. But they said no. And the reality is our current need is in these areas, these particular areas.
And you think you'll be able to fill that position fairly quickly or easily, or what's your take on that?
I hope so. You know, HR does the very best they can, and especially something like this that would be time sensitive. I know it's a resource thing, but this last year they've been so helpful in understanding when it is something that's time sensitive.
Yeah. I'm just wondering how competitive, or I mean, you know, I'm not familiar with positions at all. Is there a lot of?
It is. I would expect a lot of interest. I don't think there'll be a lack of candidates.
Okay.
Yes, right. if that was your question.
Yeah. That,
okay.
Thank you.
Okay. All right.
So Barbara, if I understood you right, you have two people now that work in this area of victim assistance.
We have our long-term coordinator, mm-hmm. Who has announced her retirement as of June 30th, mm-hmm. and we are about to fill, hopefully this week, an entry-level advocate. And this is definitely more of a higher-level skill set.
Okay.
Yeah, and that'll be it, and then we'll have to work on refilling the coordinator position.
Okay. And then in here I see a vehicle for $21,950 as a county match. Is that our contribution that is being requested?
Yes.
So it's really the purchase of a vehicle?
Yeah, because my vision is to have the advocate be able to respond to crime scenes with us, mm-hmm. and also go to victims and go to the VNOX when needed. Mm-hmm. You know, there's sometimes a lot of paperwork. There's meetings. There's things that victims need to do because law enforcement's asking them to do it. You know, hey, you know, we need a picture of the child when they were 8. You know, can you look through your photos? Can we look through some yearbooks? And that's a lot to ask a victim to do. My vision would be that if this person can establish a relationship with these two populations, that they can be assistants. And they might be able to go to the house. They might be able to go meet them in a remote area instead of having to come all the way down to the DA's office.
Do you have a vehicle now?
We do not. I have two emergency vehicles unmarked. I only allow my DAIs to drive them. It's not because I don't trust my employees, but sometimes the lights and sirens are maybe tempting. Anyway, I have my DAI vehicles, and we do have a small sedan, but it has a B problem, and it's not reliable.
Okay.
It's just not reliable. We don't take it outside the government center or very, very far outside of San Andreas. It's just not very reliable at all, and it has a B problem we can't seem to resolve.
So our county match to this program is basically purchasing the vehicle, as I understand it, and I see building improvements?
Yes.
So what's that about?
The building is because, as I explained earlier, we do not have a place in our office to meet with victims. We usually have to take them off-site somewhere else in the government center, you know, which is fine. We're willing to do that, of course, as a service to the victims. By bringing in yet more victim services staff, mm-hmm. it's going to require another location. I've talked with the chief probation officer, and the little juvenile hall building that is out back in this parking lot is used very seldom. We discussed it, and he felt that if I had a greater need and it was fulfilled a greater need and it served a greater purpose, in the county, he'd be willing to let us use that building. It's not ADA compliant. It would need some work. We would be unable to have any victim of the disabilities come in. And we actually had that situation a couple months ago. Two people coming in wheelchairs, mm-hmm. and we couldn't have them in our office. It's not physically possible. And so, you know, we use the sheriff's office, which is fine. And I think the sheriff's office is definitely willing to do that for us if the room is available.
I'm just trying to narrow it down on building improvements.
Okay.
If this is improving the building that you're in, like adding an office for this person, but you're looking at some outside space in order to meet victims. And this
Correct.
Is what this $10,000 match would be.
And that's an estimate based on the estimate a few years ago, mm-hmm. Which I believe from person to person came down from Zachariah. So I have no specific knowledge on what it's going to take. That was just the old estimate.
Okay.
So it's not perfect, but mm-hmm. if we could upgrade that building, it is a place where we could meet victims. And it would be a private place, it'd be on campus, but not too far, mm-hmm. And hopefully help us treat them in the respectful way that they deserve.
Okay, thank you.
And District Attorney Yoka and I have had some discussions around that, and there are still some if that match, if that building will work and there's not sufficient funds within the parameters of the county match of the grant, there are some available funds that can only be used for capital projects, and that is the COP, certificates of participation.
And on the vehicle after 2 years, would we have to give that back, or?
You know, my understanding by talking with Kelly Figueroa from the Crisis Center, who works with Cal OES grants a lot, is that it just turns over to county property. But I have not checked into it. I have not asked Cal OES that specific question. Mm-hmm. You know, the other thing is when this grant came out, the deadline was very, very short. It was very short. So if there is a better purpose that the board could see for the $42,000 match, I'm open to that. These were just some ideas that were put forward, except, you know, the facility is a big one for us. Mm-hmm. It's a big one for mm-hmm. us, so. Okay. Any other questions?
I do. Okay. More comments than anything. So, you know, I'm in favor of this because, for one, when you have a victim like you're talking about, especially children, it just doesn't stop after the first visit.
Yep.
It continues on. If you have some of your investigators currently that are trying to engage, or you know, they have to do their work. I think it's a really good idea to be able to have somebody give that extra care, and it could actually save money in the long run, because you're using your other resources for something else, instead of not using them for something else, number one. And number two, you might establish a little better relationship with your victim to begin with, to be able to get more out of them that needs to be captured, so to speak. So the car, right? The vehicle, I would think that would come to the county anyhow, because it's purchased. And as far as the capital improvements, we should be starting on that anyhow. So I'm in favor of this. Very much.
I have a quick question, Mr. Chair. It's $42,000. That's general fund plan or monies, and it'd be $21,000 for 2 years.
That's correct.
Thanks.
And it would be upon awarding of the grant, once we know that we get the grant for sure, that we would have to return to the board to get approval for the limited term position for 2 years and for the purchase of the capital asset.
That's correct. This is just to apply for the grant, but obviously you have to sign off on it, and we don't want to go through the process if you weren't in support of the match, but we might not get it. So, but if we do, we would come back and present it.
One more question, Chair. District Attorney, this will be a full-time employee position for 2 years?
It would, and we do have an overtime budget, because as I explained, we would be expecting this person to go out to crime scenes. If I'm going and my investigator's going, we'd be bringing the advocate with us, and we'd be expecting this person to be available for victims when they need it.
The board should realize that in a situation where we do have a homicide or a death involving criminal activity and there's charging, these cases will be in court for probably well over 2 years. So I don't think there's going to be a lack of work for this position.
Unfortunately not.
But just to be understood, that the position would be, since it is a grant-funded position, it would be limited term, limited for the length of the time of the grant.
Yeah.
That's correct.
So you got 2 years basically to document the value of that, and you know, see what, I mean, it could be to where it's a benefit that county may want to invest in that in the future, so, right?
It's actually two employees, is that right? Two victim witness employees?
No, it's just one.
One.
Okay, it says 80 hours times 1821. Maybe I'm reading that wrong or just not understanding it.
Right, 9A.
Is that for the full 2 years? Was it?
Yes.
Okay.
So it's doubling up them, just a quote for 2 years?
The one position for 2 years,
okay,
yeah.
Okay, I got you. Thank you.
Okay, any public comments?
Any?
Peter Race, gentlemen. I like this idea and I fully support it. But what I would hope that down the road, not just the DA, but future any and all agencies, great idea, public supports it. They should come out when comes budget time, show the numbers of accomplishment. I mean, what was accomplished? That's why I got such a respect for the probation department. That tall guy comes in, he has the guts to come out and say, hey, this is what I accomplished. And it's been lacking for many, many years, and I don't recall ever. You all come out, hey, this is what we're gonna do. But it would be nice to see what was accomplished. We're not running a Miss America contest, what they wanna do in the future. Let's see what was accomplished, and I think we get a support 2 years from now, when it's gonna be come up again. It would be nice to get a count, and if the DA had a problem showing the numbers, I believe Ms. The controller auditor is involved in this also. So either the DA can or controller, auditor controller could come in and said, this was accomplished and it was worthwhile and this is the money it went for. So account for the accomplishment so they can get the proper credit and recognition for the good work they're doing. Thank you.
Okay. Any other public comments? All right, bring back the board.
So, Chairman, I have a question because it's coming out of the general fund and I see these as more capital type improvements. Is that correct? Or?
The improvements to our building would be a capital improvement. So that could come out of the CIP fund. As I mentioned, the certificates of participation. The vehicle would be a general fund cost.
Any other board discussion? Can I have a motion, please?
So move.
I have a motion by Supervisor Olivera.
Second.
Second by Supervisor Kearney. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you. So there is a certificate of assurance, I think, that has to be signed. I don't know if we have enough forms for it. I don't know if it's two wet signatures or just one. We can figure that out and bring it back this afternoon for signature.
Okay.
All right. Thank you. We'll do that, and then, of course, we'll let you know if we get it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Peter.
All right. We'll move on to the consent agenda. Consent agenda items are expected to be routine and non-controversial. They will be acted upon by the board at one time without discussion. Any board member, staff member, or interested party may request removal of an item for the consent agenda for later discussion. And so, Karen?
Do you want me to read them all? Okay, number 10 from the planning department. Authorize the planning department to issue a full refund of $6,843 for 2016-019 snow tentative parcel map for withdrawal of project. Number 11.
Karen?
Is it Karen? Sorry. Don't worry about reading all of them.
Oh, okay.
Right.
Well, since she started.
Well, I mean, she's going to read all of them.
There's four, five.
Let's not make it a routine, though.
Yes. So go ahead.
Oh, okay. Item 11, Public Works, authorize the request to replenish the impressed cash fund at Red Hill Transfer Station and authorize the attached request for relief of liability. Item 12, Administrative Office, adopt a resolution continuing a local state of emergency on tree mortality. Item 13, Administrative Office, adopt a resolution continuing the local state of emergency. And item 14, Administrative Office, adopt a resolution continuing the local health state of emergency by Environmental Health Director and County Health Officer.
Okay. Any members of the public wish to pull an item in the consent agenda?
14, please.
Number 14. Okay, anybody else in the public? All right, board?
Number 11, Chair. Thank you.
Okay. Can I have a motion on the remainder?
So moved.
Motion by Supervisor Kearney.
Second.
Second by Supervisor Olivera. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, so number 11, Supervisor Olivera.
I understand this to be replenish the impress cash fund at Red Hill and the attached request for relief of liability. Would that be from our contractor, or what is the release of liability for? Do we know?
It's just a language that there's nobody to collect that loss from because it was it was a missing, so we can write it off the books.
So we're missing a cash bank.
Yeah.
Do we know the amount we're missing?
It says it was a recent theft of $1,316, which is in here, $100 of which was impressed cash. So the auditor's office issues $100 in impressed cash, and the relief of liability is to basically write off that loss of $100 that was originally issued to them as impressed cash, and then issue them another $100.
So as I understand it, our contractor operates Red Hill. Is that true?
That is my understanding, but yeah,
and do they collect the money from Dunkies?
They operate the transfer station, the green waste disposal. I wish Public Works were here. They know more about who.
Can we call them?
Hopefully they're listening.
I'd appreciate it.
I can.
I'd like to know where the loss is. And if it's our contractor.
It's
well.
I know a little bit about it.
Okay.
It's actual keeping the money in a box that's been collected for the day at their facility, and we've had break-ins that steal it. And that's where the loss is. Maybe Jeff is here now.
I haven't heard the questions, but I don't know.
He's sprinted over here, so go ahead.
Hello, Mr. Kravitz. How are you?
I'm doing okay, running around. Jeff Kravitz, Public Works Department. I'm assuming you pulled the consent item dealing with our security issues at the Red Hill closed landfill with the two transfer station sites. There's been a history of security issues up there. We've had fences cut by adjacent growers. We've had water, essentially, pilfered out of our water systems. We've had some previous break-ins at the gatehouse of the annex, the green waste facility. And this one was a double break-in. It was a break-in at the transfer station, which was a steel building. Oh, no, actually, this one is at the annex as well, wasn't it? Annex. Anyway, so this particular robbery was in two locations. They broke through a lock gate, cut a lock off of a Connex box where we store a pump that we use to move leachate from pond to pond. And they also broke into the facility box at the annex site, took a microwave, and took impressed cash. We have now changed all procedures. We do no longer keep cash overnight when there is not staff there. Cash is now going to the Gambie offices every night after work. And we're in the process of changing all of our locks. And on our Connex box, which is a box where we use to store our equipment that we need to maintain the closed landfill, we're doing some protection so they can't get a bolt cutter onto that lock. This is the paperwork that's necessary for us to replace that cash that was stolen. So that's basically the story of what was going on out there.
I was unaware we had a break-in there. Was that reported to the Sheriff's Department to conduct an investigation?
Yes, it was. And we do have a report on it, but we're not allowed to include the report in your board package. So, yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Crowe.
Any other questions?
It's been a problem, Mike, the board. If you'll read it, there's been several of them. So I think what Director Krovitz is really trying to relate is that it finally took maybe it took this to create a real change where they no longer leave cash in the on premises. So it's not the first time. If you'll read it, there's been several throughout, but it's the first time somebody took action to prevent this going forward.
In an ideal world, we would not be taking cash at our transfer stations.
I'd like to see that day.
I'd like to see that day as well.
We're working towards it.
Okay.
So, but in the real world, I could have told you that businesses around here, they don't keep cash in their business at the end of the day. You know, I learned that one real quick. Being broke into 11 times at my restaurant in the past, and the first thing they do is take the cash register, even though it's empty. And so then you learn to open the cash register so that they can walk up and see that it's open and there's nothing in it. So it's not a really good idea, if anybody's listening, don't leave cash in your business. It's just the way it is. And so and if you have a cash register, just leave it open. Otherwise, you'll find it out in the field next to your business, pried open. So luckily, we've had pretty good success lately with the sheriff's office have been doing door shakers and door checks and things like that, and it's cut it down a lot. So anyhow, so just I guess you guys won't be leaving any cash in there anymore, right?
Nope.
Yeah.
Not at any of the transfer stations.
Good.
And we have a secure facility for cash at Rock Creek, but that doesn't stop them from attempting to break into the buildings.
Yes. You know, it's just an inherent problem anywhere, I think. So, all right. Any other questions for Mr. Klobitz? No? Any other public comments?
This was happening before Father you came on, by the way, previous. There's got to be a solution. Don't even.
You're right, and I think he's got the solution.
Okay.
You can't steal it if it's not there.
Can I have a motion by the board, please?
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Supervisor Kearney, second by Supervisor Ponte. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? None. All right, item number 14. The resolution continuing the local health state of emergency by environmental health director and county health officer.
I just have a question on this item. How did those toxic material get up there to start with?
I couldn't hear you.
How did all these toxic materials that create a health problem was there to start with, and for how many years? I mean, I believe, yes, you're going to burn some stuff, going to be a smoke and stuff. Now, the smoke is gone. But what are we going to do, and why was it there to start with all these toxic materials? We have building inspectors and whatever inspectors you want. But it's been for many, many years, everybody ignored it. Now, is there still right now, you have toxic materials on this for the health servicer, health director, health officer? What health dangers do we have after all these months and these sites? Do we still have those health material, hazardous to health material on those sites? Is it still there? Is there a time element when it's going to be removed?
I'm not the health officer, Mr. Race, but I have, and they're not here right now, unfortunately, but I have dealt a lot with the solid waste issues lately and have heard them make presentations. Why was the toxic waste on site? Old building issues, things of that nature that when it burned down, it created it. When they're cleaning these sites, and I forgot the exact number, but there have been thousands of truckloads of toxic waste trucked out of the county to Forward Landfill in Manteca. I mean, it's, last I heard it was over 3,000 truckloads. One company's doing over 300 a day at one time. Now, they've cleaned, I won't put words in the health officer's mouth. You could ask him to get the exact figures, but once they've cleaned these sites, they are certified as being clean. That way, the property owner can go forward with their own plans, whether it's to sell it or rebuild. So hopefully, there is no toxic waste on the site once they've cleaned it up, and it's in Forward Landfill now in Manteca. Rock Creek does not take burned material.
Okay, so my question is, how many land sites got cleaned, and how many more you got to go?
He would have to give you the exact update, okay. But as far as I know, he's the last we were told, it was 475 homes that had been done. Over, am I right?
There are,
no.
Over 95% of the homes have been, the sites have been cleaned.
Buildings in addition to the
right.
Homes.
Right.
Well, there's a lot of things. So if you burn, let's say, for instance, treated wood, okay? Treated wood, once it burns, it turns into an arsenic material. You got your household chemicals. They all turn into something that's, okay? So, I mean, nothing's been ignored all these years. It's just when the fire came, it turned them into something that was a certain way. Now, they take a soil sample, and a neutral soil sample from the site, near the site, and then they clean the site to try to get as close as you can within 3%, I believe it is, of that soil sample. Because what you want to do is you want to bring it back to where it was before the fire.
And Mr. Chairman, I don't interrupt you. I'm not questioning the validity and the need for it, okay? But I'm questioning that after all these months, this poison, this hazardous material, is how soon it's going to be taken care of? Is that for eternal job security?
There's only like maybe six sites left. And a lot of them are trying, just because they're trying to contact people. So really it's 99% complete.
Okay, beautiful. Thank you.
And he's exactly right. As was presented during the last Solid Waste Task Force meeting, the sites that haven't been cleaned are because they're just now getting permission to do it, or they couldn't find the person that owned the property, etc. So otherwise,
it would have been done. Okay. Then you can eliminate the emergency situation.
They found one property owner, some lady in Oklahoma.
That's a long walk.
Yeah, it was. It was a long walk back, too.
Thank you.
And just as a follow-up, even though the vast majority of the sites, with only a few remaining, have been cleaned, this will stay on as an item for continuing emergency because it's required so that we can continue to receive the federal and state aid that we have applied for.
Yeah, and if you go to our website out there, you can see as a press release, May 9th, 2016, approximately 850 properties have been cleaned up of the 856. So yeah, Cliff was right, there's six left out there. So kudos to everybody doing a great job getting that cleaned up.
Yeah, especially
it's a good progress, thank you.
Okay, any other public comments? Board comments? Can I have a motion, please?
Move to approve.
Okay. Motion by Supervisor Kearney.
Second.
Second by Supervisor Wright, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
No.
Yes. All right, so we are, our next part of this meeting will be continue at 1:30 p.m. here. We're gonna go back into closed session, and at 12 o'clock, we have a frog jump kickoff out right outside here, and so I sure would like to see all eight of you there.
Chair, would you like to get supervisor announcements out of the way?
I think it's more important that we get into closed session.
Yeah, we can do that after the ordinance issue.
Okay.